Hello, this is Dr. Gary Hawkins with the University of Georgia Crop and Soil Science Department and UGA Extension. Today we will be demonstrating how to use the Enviroscape Watershed model. Funding for this video has been in part from Georgia's EPD 319 program. Today we will be using the Enviroscape Watershed model to show pollution sources and identify ways we can deal with pollution on the landscape. Specifically, we will be concentrating on the construction site located in the upper corner of the model to show how construction can negatively affect the health of our watershed and some practices we can use to ensure the safety of our rivers, lakes, and streams. As you see, we have our city-urban area laid out, which was featured in a previous video. But today we're going to go just above it and focus on our construction site. Now the first thing we need to do is put some water in our lake. So we'll pour a little water in our lake out of our squirt bottle. The next thing we are going to do is, just for video purposes, is remove our trees so we can see the construction site a little bit better. As you can see, we've got our construction equipment represented here through our excavator on site. So for purposes of easily demonstrating pollution, I'm going to remove it out of the way. Again, as you saw in the previous video, we used our canister of powdered drink mix, but instead of it being fertilizer today, we're going to use it for our soil. This soil comes from the removal of grass and some of the vegetation that takes place when a piece of land is being cleared for construction. So we'll use our red drink mix to represent this loose soil. Now that we've removed the grass and vegetation from our construction site, let's see what happens when it gets a little bit of rain. If we get a little bit of rain, just like in some of our other videos, you'll see where the water starts to accumulate and it starts to, in this case, move that soil across the ground. At this point, when water hits the ground, it's called splash erosion. Splash erosion, as you see in the picture, looks like a little bomb hitting the ground. It hits that soil in such a high velocity that it actually causes the soil to move. Now, when we get a little bit more rain, you can start to see that soil moving a little bit further. If someone is building a house in this empty lot, for instance, we already have the street paved. Any additional water causes this soil to run straight downhill. That'll move this soil into stormwater drains. As we get enough rain moving down, then that sediment will get pushed through our stormwater drain and out into our rivers and creeks and go down into our lake. So from our construction site, that's really one of our main sources of pollution. This exposed dirt that gets dislodged when it rains and flows down into our curb and streets and into our stormwater drain, which empties out towards our rivers and lakes. If we're dealing with a construction site that is anywhere above an acre or more of disturbed surface, it has to get what is called an NPDS permit, and that's the National Pollutant Discharge Elimination System permit. This allows the construction site to release a certain amount of pollutants into the water system, but not enough to severely disrupt the health of the watershed. To cut down on these pollutants, a site could use some best management practices, or BMPs, to reduce the flow of soil getting into our rivers. Some of these are bioretention ponds, stormwater ponds, or vegetative filters that can be placed around the system. So let's take a look at a vegetative buffer or filter. Instead of cutting all the way to the street, we can plant or leave vegetation along the street. This won't necessarily stop all the erosion, but it will certainly cut down on it. It will slow that water enough where there is some deposition of sediment into the vegetative filter strip. Unfortunately, on a construction site, this may be very narrow and may not stop much of the water flow. Once the filter gets overloaded with sediment, it cannot stop any more of the sediment that flows through. Luckily, this is not the only practice we can use. One of the other things we can do is put a stormwater retention pond. If you can see right here, there's a small indention. This is the lowest most point on the construction site and would make an optimum place for building a stormwater retention pond. A stormwater retention pond slows the water down to allow the sediment to settle out. Then the clean water, which gets separated out from the sediment, can be put back into some source of stormwater drain. Another on-site thing we can do is a bioretention pond. In a bioretention pond, you have a medium that will allow the water to slowly release out of the pond and go into the stormwater system. A bioretention pond would slow the water down, hold it in place, and allow a small amount of sediment to settle out. These ponds can become small natural habitats that allow animals and vegetation to thrive off of the clean water. So let's review our three BMPs. The vegetative filters slow water down and cause some of the sediment to deposit out until the filter gets filled up. The stormwater pond would slow the water down, filter some of it out, and remove a lot of the pollutants. and the bioretention pond slows the water down totally and holds it where it can be treated to some respect. With that, this is Dr. Gary Hawkins with University of Georgia UGA Extension. Thanks.